Center for the Technology, Innovation and Incubation.
GCTII is a technology-driven business incubator entrepreneurship cell within the premises of GCET. GCTII has been run by highly efficient multi-member board headed by Dr.S.K.Verma, chaired by Dr.V.K.Divedi, under the patronage of Mr. Sunil Galgotia and Mr. Dhruv Galgotia.
Entrepreneurship Cell, IIT Kharagpur and Tata Chemicals present EAD 2018, secured by SOFOS and in association with MapMyIndia and presented to you by Business Standard, is conducting a panel discussion to fuel the imagination of budding entrepreneurs. This session brings to you lectures from today's top business honchos, business management gurus and distinguished personalities on various startup related challenges in the country and how to sail through those. Now I would like to call forward Dr. Praveen Madhuri sir, S.K. Verma sir, Bipin sir, Reema ma'am and all our dignitaries for light writing ceremony.
GCTII, the incubation department of the Galgotia Educational Institution and more specifically GCT, Galgotia Engineering College, in a very short span of time has become a name of its own and it has carved out a place in the field of incubation. This is the incubation department. Here we actually try to transform the learning process of the student from theoretical to into project-based one, and we give a continuous rigorous, in fact, training to their students how they should conceptualize the business idea and how they should go on processing the ideas into tangible products and services. And with the due, you know, just support and funding from different ministries, such as MSME, DST, and CDB, we try to fund the projects of the students also and help them commercialize their business ideas. So, instead of taking too much of time, because it is already very late and our guests are waiting for their turn to turn up, I request and also just to take privilege to welcome our chief guest, Mr. Sujit Kumar. He is a man in just 50s, but very young, with heart and mind also. He is an IIT Kharagpur product, and he has been in US for over 20 years in corporate world. Now settled down in Bangalore with family and also running his own company. He's a member of various universities in a board of governors, governing body, and has been very actively associated with our Mr. Vinay Pathak, the AKTU, in fact, a vice chancellor. So we are very privileged to welcome him on behalf of the Galgotia family to please come and also give just inaugural speech of a few sentences to enlighten us with his enriched experiences. Welcome, sir.
The guests, media persons, and our lovely students, ladies and gentlemen, indeed it's an honor and privilege to be here. He mentioned my around age also, and yes, I have some gray hairs, but definitely sitting and standing in front of this crowd, feel much younger, much younger. And I can tell you, I started my entrepreneurial journey around 23 years back. And I can see, after seeing this energy, I can start tomorrow another entrepreneurship job. I can restart my journey. So that type of energy I see here, indeed it's a privilege. I have been asked this session be more interactive session than just talking session. So I'll try my best to spend more time on question answer type session. But before I come to the question answer, so just I thought a few words about entrepreneurship I'll share, and then I would love to hear questions from you all. I was just thinking, how you define entrepreneurship? Is this starting a company? Is that entrepreneurial journey? Is it making a product as an entrepreneurial journey? Is it marketing that product as an entrepreneurial journey? How do you define entrepreneur? But I can tell you, the beautiful part of entrepreneurial journey is, even if you fail, you learn a lot. So in an entrepreneurial journey, you never fail. And that doesn't mean you go and fail. You start your journey to fail, not that. But don't worry about the failure. You should have enough risk-taking ability. And just I was thinking, what are the few characteristics I can define for the entrepreneurship? Most and far most important thing is passion and motivation. Of the area where you want to work, you should be passionate about that. You should be motivated about that. You should be self-disciplined. There's no boss if you are having an entrepreneurial journey. You should be self-boss of yourself. And I can tell you, most difficult thing to become the self-boss. Most difficult thing. If you are able to do that, then you are there. You should have a good financial management. You should understand the finances exactly, because any entrepreneurial journey, finance plays very, very vital role. And that decides, that is one of the key factors in success and failure. So you should be very, very good in numbers. And just we all are sitting guests together, and we are discussing about some of the entrepreneurship. Most of the time, you see he or she was very good in numbers. So you should be very good in all this type of things. Then yes, you should have knowledge of your product, knowledge of market. Understanding market is very, very important. When I say understanding market, it is who are going to use your product. How big is the market for that? So these are the, I can keep going, go on and on and on on this, what all the type of, one entrepreneur should have. But before I conclude and come to the question answer session, I thought I'll just give an example about entrepreneur journey. And entrepreneur journey is like you are in a forest. You are going in a forest. And I can tell you that it is like this. Sometimes lion can come, and you don't know, पीछे से snake आ जाएगा, side से monkey आ जाएंगे. Sometimes flood will come, rain will come, sometimes earthquake may come, you may find a crack in the, your road. So that is entrepreneurship journey. But I can tell you, the good part of this journey is you have also weapons with you. You have lots of weapons with you to fight with all these, you know, hurdles will come into your path. Sometimes you have to make some of them as your friend. Sometimes you have to kill them also. I'm not saying killing, not in this sense of killing, shooting, not in that sense. But sometimes you have to do that also. Sometimes you have to make them partner. Sometimes you have to ignore. So all this type of skills you should have while you're doing the entrepreneurial journey. And this type of things can. But I've been asked to go for question answer mode. So I'll just probably hear some questions so that I can interact with you. So that way probably that was the motto of this session. So any probably start question?
Feel free to ask any questions. Yeah. Yes, sir.
My question is how to start an entrepreneurship? Like what things I must keep in my mind while starting this journey?
Oh, you ask yourself, can I start? If answer is yes, then you start. That is the one. Then it comes, what all things I should have to start that journey. But I think you are the best judge of yourself to start journey. No, I don't think anyone else can influence, hey, yeah, this is the right time to start journey. See, entrepreneurial journey, even if you are in the say, first year of your engineering college, you can start that time. And even when you are 65 years old, that time also you can start your entrepreneurship. So there's no age, no geography, it's nothing like that. Once you ask yourself, yes, I can do it, you can. Then yes, there are certain steps you have to follow. While going for that step, what problem I am addressing, right? What type of backing I have? What type of networks I have? Or where is the market for this thing? All this type of attributes you have to then confirm with yourself. But end of the day, it's ask yourself, can I start today? If the answer is yes, just go and start. That doesn't mean you leave your class and then go and start it. That doesn't mean I'm not encouraging that you to stop your education in between and go and start that. But yes, that is the best way.
We talk about entrepreneurship. Is it always a project-based thing, or you can take an idea of yourself and then push it to another level? Like, should it always be like product-centered, or can it be different from product? Like, you can have an idea and you can push it forward, like start an institution of a kind. And like,
yeah, is that entrepreneurship always product-based? Do you think founder of Infosys were entrepreneur?
Yes.
Is Infosys a product-based company? Answer is no. At the same time, if I give example of say Google, is a product-based company and they are also entrepreneur, right? Or Oracle, right? So then entrepreneurship journey is nothing like product or service. It is innovation which you are bringing, right? What problem you are trying to solve? And is the someone ready to pay you for solving that problem? As long as this is there, you are there.
We can say traditional product-based service,
product-based
company.
Our product, what is the product cost, in your opinion?
Take an example of, I'm from a chemical. I can give an example of computer science, like one person makes an application of a kind and another company purchases that application at a good price. So that will be like a product-based service. And you can start a search engine of your own, or you can start a software company. That is a service-based, what I find, for me. So when we see for a particular product base, then it can go to a company and then it can, like, you start a product, you sell it, and then there is a full stop. You have to work on a new product and then sell it, then it is another full stop. Okay. And for services, you can, like, you have a very broad aspect for that. Like, you can go in this direction. So, for IIT, the service base is good.
Okay. That's fine. I mean, all opinions are good. Do you think you can find a common denominators? If we just name a few entrepreneurs and try to find what is the common, is there some common denominators? And that is that's where entrepreneurship comes from the picture. However, there are certain things you should have about that, and I think this is what I was trying to say. Like, say for example, passionate. You should be passionate about what you are doing. You should have knowledge of the product. You should have knowledge of the market, right? You should have enough connect. You should have enough backing where, you know, even if you are in a difficult situation, how is it that you come out of that? And most important thing is a difficult situation, how did I come out of that? Because entrepreneurial journey is, I put it like this, it looks very interesting, and of course it's interesting, but it's very tough. Indeed, it is a tough journey. So you will have lots of ups and downs. Like say, for example, we all hear about Flipkart story. But there are maybe 20 or 25 or 100 companies which you could not survive. Right? We all know about Flipkart, but there are 99 other companies we don't know. Right? So, but as an entrepreneur, all 100 were entrepreneurs. So that you should have ability to, and there are a few more things like how you have ability to think, when is that I come out of it? When I can say, no, you are enough. So all these are the successful, that makes you more and more successful. But that doesn't mean if one of things are missing, you are not, you can't be entrepreneur. No, it's very, 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 no thumb rule.
Sir, hello PI department, to present our guest with memento and sapling.
Physical product, things that can touch and feel. You know, you're building a car, that is a product, building a machinery, that is a product, and things that you can't touch and feel was a service. Like you know, you're providing an agency service, you are providing whatever. Nowadays, with technology coming in, even some of the products are certain things that you cannot touch and feel. You know, a Google search is a product, it's not a service. You know? Facebook is a product, though you cannot go and touch Facebook, right? So, or a Flipkart is a product. So, the basic now difference is more in terms of scalability. What is the thing that you can scale, that you can grow without adding more people? You know, the beautiful part about a product is that you build a product and then the same product can be used by 10, 100, 1000, 10,000, 10 million, 10 crores. Doesn't matter. That is a product. But a service, if you have to take it from 10 customers to 100 customers to 1000 customers, you have to keep adding people. You know, if one person is servicing 5 people, then to service 50 people, you need 10 employees. Okay? While in a product company, once you build the product, it can serve as many people as you want. So that is the basic difference between the two. That's how industry looks at it. So in the long run, product ideas are always better. Okay? Service is very good to do in the short run. Agar aapko this year, if you want to do something quickly, you can do a service, get some revenue. But long run, if you look at all the big entrepreneurs, they're all product entrepreneurs. You know, like if you look at the top 20, top 100, you know, that is where you see, even though Infosys, it's like big, but you cannot compare the kind of wealth that a Mark Zuckerberg has or Google founders have with what Infosys has. You know? And I'm not saying Infosys is bad. they also have their own place in the world. But if you want to take something, I mean, to that level, it's always the product that wins in the long run. Okay? Because the simple fact that a service is not scalable. You cannot scale. You know? After a certain level. And just think about product service, like somebody who's taking a tuition at home, you know, is providing a service. Okay? While if you go online and look up the same tutorial on YouTube, you know, that is kind of a product, you know. Or you go to some, you know, like Baiju, whatever it is. The online videos, you go, log in, you view, you know, because once that guy has created the video, it doesn't matter. 10, 100, 1000. But the person who is taking the tuition, I mean, if his class size goes beyond 20, 30, if he has to serve 500 people, 1000 people, then you need more teachers. Okay? So that's the basic difference. And that's actually one of the basic lacunas of the Indian startup system. That even though we have been there, even though there has been Infosys, there hasn't been great products. That's a very big criticism for our markets, and that's something that people say. So if you have a product ideas, and the reason also is that to have a product idea and to take it to market, it's a very investor-driven strategy. You know, you need to invest first, okay? And to invest first, you need a good ecosystem. You need investors, you need technical partners, you need people who believe and trust you, etc., etc. Because initially, there is no money, you have an idea, you are building it, whether you are hiring engineers or machinery, whatever it is. Before you start making a single money, you have to invest 10 crores, 15 crores, or 5 crores, and then you can start making money. Service pe, agar aapko English aati hai, you know English, you can start teaching people English, you know, and you start making money, or whatever it is, you know. Flipkart, whatever service will be that, you know, somebody starts a shop, you know, like e-commerce shop, starts delivering online. Okay, so that was a little bit about that. I thought I should just clarify. So my name is Amitabh Verma, and I currently run this company called Amp Digital. Okay, and we do a couple of things. One is we provide training. And our training is online training, you know. And all of it is done through partners, you know, like how many of you know a company called Internshala? Internshala? Oh, yeah. If you go to Internshala, you know there are training programs in Internshala? Yeah. So if you go and if you look for digital marketing training program, you know, it's my program. Okay? If you sign up for it, if you look at the page, they will talk about this program is run by AMP Digital. Okay? So that's what we do. We create training programs, the technology, the content, and we give it to our partners like Internshala, who run it. Okay? There's another company called IRFS Skills, the country's largest skilling provider. Okay? So they run our training program, etc. We also do our own thing. Second thing we do is that we create products. So we have a product called a news product, you know, meant for marketers again, wherein people can go there and read up what is happening in digital marketing world. And there are only 4 or 5 articles every day, which we feel are genuine articles and that a marketer needs to know. So currently the challenge is that to learn about what's happening in the world, you have to go to multiple places. You waste time. You are a student, you are a professional, you don't have too much time. You have 5 minutes every day, 10 minutes every day. You go to the website and it'll tell you what is happening right now. Okay, so in 5 minutes you can go through it. Okay, that is called newsapp.io. Okay, so that's what we do. Then we also work with some companies and manage their digital marketing. Before this, I worked for Google for about 7 years. And my last role was that I managed the global SMB, global small and medium advertisers. Okay? So anyone across the world who went to google.com and signed up as an advertiser, me and my team used to manage that. Okay? So I had a very large team, I had about 350 people, last there was some outsourced housing people, whatever. So that's what I did, and before that I was with ICICI Bank, etc. I did my MBA from IIM Kozhikode. So today I'm just going to speak about one thing which is very close to me, which is personal branding. Okay? And why is it relevant in this entrepreneurship world is that when you become an entrepreneur, the basic difference between finding a job and becoming an entrepreneur is that an entrepreneur is all about yourself. Like whatever you do, whether get a product, get a customer, get a revenue, will be because of you initially. Okay? While if you become an employee of Google and Facebook, they're all or Infosys or whatever, they're already big brands. Okay? So there you will be one amongst 1 lakh people. Here it will be just you. Okay? So when you start out, you know, it's all about how people perceive you. So if you come to me and say, Amitabh, I've got this product, why don't you use this product? Or I've got this service, why don't you use? First thing I'll think about is you. Who are you? Okay? Can I trust you? That's the first question people will think. Okay? So that's where this personal branding is very important. How do you brand yourself so that when you go with your product and service to somebody, they trust you? Okay? So how do you build that trust in the system is what this is a little bit about. Okay? So this is the startup of you. Okay? If you get time, there is also a book by the same name. Okay? The book is written by a person called Reid Hoffman. Reid Hoffman. Anyone knows who is Reid Hoffman? Reid Hoffman? Kone ha? Okay, anyone knows? Okay, no. So Reid Hoffman started a company called LinkedIn. We all know LinkedIn? Yeah, he's the founder of LinkedIn. And then he wrote a book about his experiences. You know, what does LinkedIn do? It's a networking site for professionals. Okay? So he wrote a book called The Startup of You. He also says that no matter whether you are working for your own or working for a corporate, Infosys, Google, Facebook, ICICI Bank, you need to think about your personal brand. It's about how you manage your career. Okay? So I've taken some of it from there. Okay? So that's what I'm going to talk about. Not much, about 15-20 minutes. Okay? And maybe I'll give you one or two pointers that you can do. You can follow up. Okay? So that when you are ready, when it's time for you to get a job or when it's time for you to step out in an entrepreneurial role, you are ready and prepared. Yeah.
Like, I don't connect to anything else other than that.
Okay.
But what happens is, suppose I'm pursuing something which doesn't really connect to what I want to be in life.
Yeah.
It doesn't connect to my aspirations. But due to some circumstances, I don't have anything concrete to fall back on other than that. So, according to me, my energies and all my efforts and time are going into the other direction.
Yeah.
And I want to change that.
Yeah.
So
that's where, you know, we find. So aapko do cheez samajhna padega, okay? Even when you are doing an entrepreneurship, there are a lot of things you will be asked to do that you will not like. Wo to hoga. In fact, jyada hoga. Okay? Because as an entrepreneur, you have to do everything. Aap ye nahi bol sakte ki main chaprasi ka kaam nahi karunga. Tujhe karna padega. I mean, jaise your physical office, lot of places you have to go, take your keys open. Okay? Aapko khud chai banana padega. Okay, आप खुद पानी लाना पड़ेगा, you know, you have to do everything. Some days आपका sweeper नहीं आया, आपको झाड़ू भी लगाना पड़ेगा. Whether you like it or not, okay? So you are, if you want to sign up for that, you have to train your mind that ठीक है, this is what I am doing, this is needed for my success. Okay? So take the same attitude towards your career also. So say that, look, मेरे को for my success as an entrepreneur, one key attitude is to do things which I don't like doing. So let me try it at somebody else's expense. You know, the best learning happens when somebody else is paying for you to learn. So if you go on your own, you put your own money, and then you are learning, and then you are not finding it good, then you are wasting your money. But if you find a job, you work for somebody, and then you don't do well, at least somebody else is paying for you. Okay? So think about it, you know?
The other thing is that I tell people that don't jump into entrepreneurship just because you want to do entrepreneurship. आपके पास एक आइडिया होना चाहिए. It should be a business idea. And until that, until you don't have that, until you have spoken to four or five people who say, oh, it's good, it's, you know, you, it's good time. Till that doesn't happen, don't do it. Till that time, find a job. Even if you don't like the job, tell yourself that, look, boss, I have to train myself, okay, to work in situations that I don't like. That will be your key asset, okay, when you get out and start working for your own. Okay, and I'll tell you one last thing. Great because they can hit other people. They are great because they can take that much more. Okay, he said that, look, I can tell you that I'm not the, my box doesn't have the maximum punch, you know, but I can tell you that when somebody is beating me, I can stand there for much longer than anyone else in the world. Okay, I think that's a key attribute if you want to become an entrepreneur or even otherwise. Okay, can you sustain yourself when everything is against you? Can you take that hit on your face and still keep moving forward? If you can do that, I can tell you that there is nobody who can stop you from being successful. Okay, because you're falling down, still you're getting up. Okay, and maybe 10 times when you get up, you will be successful. But you have to try this 10 times. You know, you have to take that hit. Okay, thank you.
I'd like to call forward Dr. Bipin Srivastava, sir, so that he can present our guest with a memento and sampling. He is the CEO of 5 Ideas Startup Superfuel. He is an entrepreneurial growth leader who has led new technology and traditional business across countries and industries. Having led sales, strategy instruments, market entities across Asia, as well as business for Fortune 100 companies, sir is very passionate about building innovative and practical solutions for growing the digital economic system of the country. I'd like to call forward upon the
So they've given me a really difficult topic. Okay, it's about funding in the ecosystem and when is the right time to start your own ventures. How many of you are familiar with the startup ecosystem per se? And accordingly, I will try and accommodate your knowledge levels and familiarity with concepts as we move forward. How many of you are familiar? Do you know what a venture capital business is? Venture capital is? Anybody? No, nobody knows what VCs are. Venture capital. One person. Two people. That's it. Three. Four. Yeah, put your hands up quicker. Okay, so very few people know what venture capital is. Do you guys know about concepts around? Do you know anything about fundraising for startups? Have you heard about startups raising money? Yes, no?
Yes.
Everyone's heard about Flipkart, oh, $1 billion raise, Oyo, oh, $1 billion raise. That much at least you guys have heard. Yes, no?
Yes.
There are people who are working in other companies who are interested in taking some exposure or making some small investments, token small investments, to test if ideas can actually move for business. Right? Can you change an idea to a business? An idea is just an idea. I want to build the fastest solar car in the world. That's a great idea. Making it into a reality and then making it into a business are two different things. You guys all understand that. Right? And we'll talk about when an idea converts to a business much later. But so angels are the most fundamental part of this ecosystem where they try and take ideas into baby business concepts, right? Now, initially that was the theme around it. Today, NGOs have become much more mature. There are people who are investing larger tickets, right? So from, you know, a couple of lakhs, now there are NGOs who invest in growth, right? So the ecosystem has become more varied. But typically, the average NGO's investment size is still sub 20 lakhs, okay? They will typically invest in the range of 5 to 10 lakhs to make sure to see if an idea can actually move to the next stage. Yeah? Are you with me? Don't sound so lost. If you guys have questions, make it interactive. Ask me, I'll sort them out. Any questions? Are you guys with me till here?
Yes.
Okay, good. So, the next one we're going to talk about is accelerators. Have you guys heard of accelerators? I believe you have an accelerator / incubator here as well. In this college.
Yes.
We do, right? Incubation. So we have an incubator here. But do you know what an accelerator is? So those baby ideas that come out from that angel stage, where you've taken that idea and it doesn't need to go through an angel, okay? You can directly work on it without anybody else invading your cap table, right? So when those ideas reach a certain stage, there are certain companies which take a small share, right, and then help you structure that into a proper plan, strategy, market testing, and then expose you to investors at the other end of the spectrum. Okay, those companies basically help you achieve through a structured process of 3 to 12 months, right, what you would normally achieve through hit and trial in much longer, right, and therefore those companies are called accelerators, right. So what they do is they take a bunch of startups, they put them into a big room, right, all the startups together, right, and they take them through the same stage, pretty much like your, like a quasi project setting in your actual studies, right? So they'll take it, and these guys will all be pretty much competitive at a certain level because they're going to be presented to the same set of investors at the end of the day. So at the end of that 3 to 4 month program, you will typically be showcased to investors at the same point in time. So think of that as your examination, right? But what that does is that it fosters an environment of accelerated learning and structured learning. So it's not ad hoc learning on the job as and when you feel like it or as and when you get some insight. They are pushing you through, this is how you make a business plan. This is how you create an alpha product. This is how you alpha test. This is how you beta test. This is how you test consumer preferences. Right? And they build that in an aggressive 4 month program. By the way, I think personally believe accelerators are the single largest boon to the startup ecosystem since I've been following it in the early 2000s, right? They take practically no equity. They invest very little, but they take practically no equity, between 5 and 10% on average, right? And they give you such a wealth of knowledge and wealth of connections that you would, as individual entrepreneurs, find it difficult to reach out. I mentored startups at several entrepreneurs, at several accelerators, right? Now, normally, I'm extremely selective about who I interact with, right? But when I'm going to a startup, when I'm going to an accelerator, that selection is already pre-curated for me. So if you make it into that accelerator that I'm mentoring, right, you already have direct access to me and 100 other mentors who are on that panel. You with me? So what do we think about accelerators? They're good stuff. Say it loudly. Okay, accelerators are good. Okay, they're a very important part of the ecosystem. Do you understand where they fit now? Right? They help you take an idea. Once you've taken that idea to a very early stage of business, right? Very early stage. They will help you take it from there through all the testing processes to where the hypothesis has been tested and the business is hitting the market, and then they will expose you to investors, right, who will take you to the next stage. So it's a very, very valuable player in the startup ecosystem. Another set of investor sharks, Shark Tank is different. Shark Tank is individual investor, right? Or they fund, they run their own fund. It's very different. And Accelerator is a structured program, like I said. It's a structured learning program, right? It's more similar to a classroom setting that you realize, right? It typically, and I talk about accelerators in detail. So typically, people have heard of accelerators like P-Labs. Are you guys familiar with any accelerators across the globe? Anyone? India, across the globe, anywhere? Thai. Okay. Anybody else? No? Okay. Fair enough. Don't worry, so there are some really, really good accelerator businesses called, it's called Unicorn. We know that at least? Yes, good. Bunch of you want to build unicorns?
Yes.
How many? First? So at least you guys need to know how to.
Idea of a business plan, but I have a blur vision of it. I'm not too sure about it, but I need to start. And what is the next step I need to take in order to consolidate it and to translate it into an actual business plan?
Talk to someone who's slightly more experienced in the space who you know. It doesn't have to be a startup specialist. Someone who can just be a sounding board for what your next steps are. Right? And if he thinks that what you have passes muster, or if after hearing his points you can defend your model to yourself, right? Put in some friends and family money and kick the damn thing off. As simple as that. I mean, just remember this, 90% of the initial funding of all great businesses, right, has actually come from friends and family. All of them started like that. Friends, family, pocket money. Okay? Everybody else comes later. Because even to an angel, right, woh bole toh kuch toh dikhao. Right? Please.
Sir, no doubt the idea of an entrepreneur should be innovative and productive. But can you focus on someone's idea in a more better way? Just make YouTube come 1 year later after Vimo, the YouTube app.
So, is the question first mover versus a latecomer to the same movement? Is that the question?
Yeah.
That do you need to be a first mover? Is that the question?
Yeah.
You know, honestly, look at it, yeah, that so many people are doing so many things which come in so much later. Right? So, in regular life, how you're wearing, what t-shirt are you wearing? What shirt are you wearing? Jack and Jones. Right? When did you start buying Jack and Jones?
2 years
ago. Huh?
2 years ago.
Before that, have you ever heard of Jack and Jones? So, does that answer your question? Good.
Why is there so much interference?